Welcome back to my channel. I'm Zuko the Flame Prince back with another video. And in today's video, I'll be continuing my listen through of Eminem's 2002 album, The Eminem Show. This is the fourth part of this album reaction. And in this video, I'll be listening to the Paul Rosenberg skit, Sing for the Moment, Superman, as well as Steve Berman. So without any further ado, let's just jump right in.
Joe just called me and he told me you're in the fucking back behind the studio, shooting your gun off in the air like it's a shooting range. I told you not to fucking bring your gun around like an idiot outside of your home. You're going to get yourself in trouble. Don't bring your gun outside of your home. You can't carry it on you. Leave your fucking gun at home.
Alright, so that was Paul Rosenberg's skit. Eminem is outside shooting his gun. I'm trying to figure out if this has any correlation to the Kiss skit, which I still think it's possible. I don't know, actually. Because I think it's possible that he saw his girlfriend or whatever outside of his studio, but that doesn't make sense unless she was baiting him. And another option is that he was coked up, so he didn't really shoot someone, he just thought it up. So I'm not sure how or where exactly this ties into the album in terms of the show, the plot of the show, whatever. But anyway, now we're going into the next track, which is Sing for the Moment. Pretty sure I've heard this one. I think Laik played it. We did. I'll leave the link somewhere in these cards. Me and Laik did a Eminem versus Jay-Z thing video a while back while I was still in Eastern Cape. And we never actually finished it. We only got through 10 out of the 20 rounds we wanted to do, but then I finished school and I left the province, so couldn't really finish that series. But I think one of the songs that he played in one of his rounds was this one. So I may have heard this song before. But yeah, let's just jump right into it. Alright, I definitely remember this song. Amazing verse. Again, Eminem painting us a vivid picture of who he is speaking for and who he represents, which is a suburban kid. Well, doesn't necessarily have to be suburban, which is a kid in white America who's also from a broken home, listening to Eminem influenced by rock and rap's rebellious spirits and stuff. I found it interesting, and I guess I appreciate Eminem saying, talking black, brainwashed by rock and rap, because I mean, if you look at like the origins of rock, which now is a predominantly, as far as I can see, it's a predominantly white space, a lot of people almost whitewash its origins, its African-American origins. So that's a cool nod. I can tell he's talking to his about his fans, but also because his fans are so much like him, you can also take this as Eminem speaking to his younger self, essentially. I think that's also pretty fire.
Only this gun, only this, only the one, only. And everybody just feels like can I raise a little girl? I couldn't, I wouldn't be fit to. You're full of shit too, Guerrero. That was a bitch that hit you.
Alright, so in the second verse, in the first verse he was talking about the fan who's receiving the music. In the second verse he's talking more so about the industry that produces the music, right? Produces his music. And he's talking about how entertainment is changing, becoming more gangsterized. And then he talks about how in that madness, his only sanctuary is within his mind, right? Keeping his gun on him. His gun is his only friend because he's lonely in this business. We hear it all the time, people saying it's lonely at the top. So that's paraphrasing that. And then speaking on the influence, he says, words are a motherfucker. They can be great or they can degrade. Matter of fact, they can teach, oh no, he says, or even worse, they can teach hate. So he's acknowledging the influence of the genre as well as his position as well, with impressionable kids hanging on to everything these rappers say, which is why oftentimes you see a lot of people getting rowdy, getting up in arms about certain messages and stuff that they don't want their children hearing. Even though he recognizes how the influence can be positive or extremely negative, he points out how they're still going platinum. The stores are still selling them because their end goal is making money. Once you get to the top, it's like, what is it? Like Jesus said, they build you up to break you down, build you up again. So these people, they rule for you, you make it to the top, and then it's like something flips, and then all of a sudden you become a public enemy. And then he also talks about how people try to paint him out to be a loose cannon, wanting to produce handguns at every moment, every opportunity. Now, to play devil's advocate or to play media's advocate or whatever, Eminem throughout this album has been pretty wild, doing coke in front of his daughter, shooting someone. Obviously, this could all be fictional, but just from what I've heard, late put his hands on his woman, shooting his gun outside in a public area, has been doing a lot of wild shit that sometimes it baffles me when he seems to not understand why people can come at him for certain things. I think baffling is the wrong word. I don't like how he'll say all this outlandish shit, do all this crazy shit, and then when people call him out for it, he acts like, oh, woe is me. Y'all just want to come at me for X, Y, Z or whatever, as if he didn't actually do some of the shit that he's being accused of. The outcry against him is politically motivated, which, again, it ought to be. If you're coming for political figures, whoever comes back at you is going to make that encounter political. So that's a bit of a misnomer. And then he does say, if I'm such a menace, how can I raise a little girl? I feel like two things can be true at the same time. So now he's, I guess this is Eminem's way of painting a more holistic picture, but now he's trying to downplay the influence that he has, saying that the music can't be what leads you to go and do harm onto someone. Or he's saying, if that is your argument, the next time you're in court, just blame it on the music. Which, I mean, this is 20 years ago, but you see the YSL Rico case, so that's not the strongest hill to stand on for Shady.
They want to get one, they think the shit's cool, not knowing we really just protecting ourselves.
Yeah, this verse, I can see Eminem's argument, but history since this song, like the past 20 years and events happening in those past 20 years would tell us otherwise, that there's a clear correlation between people rapping about totem pistols and then people in the streets increasingly toting pistols. Yep. The song, I like this verse as well. Yeah, it can be a bit of a cop out, but at the same time it is reality when someone It's a fine line to walk between glorifying something versus accounting a story of something that has taken place. So it's a very fine line to when you from a place that's about crime, there's a lot of crime or gun violence going on, and then you talk about it in songs, you have to be meticulous so it doesn't seem as though you're encouraging that sort of behavior if maybe that's a past that you come from and stuff. I have no idea what the guy in the chorus is saying. Sing for me, sing for the moment, sing for today, because tomorrow it cannot be taken away. I think that's what I heard. Which, that hook makes the most sense, I think, with the second verse where Eminem is talking about how lawyers, prosecutors want to take this life away from him by prosecuting him for gun possession or whatever, which Paul tried to warn him against in the skit, but... I can see why this is one of Eminem's classics. I can hear why. This is the next track titled Superman featuring Dina Rae. Also know this song, Drake interpolated it into a Chicago freestyle. I know you want me, baby. I think I want you too. I think I love you, baby. I think I love you too. I'm here to save you, girl. Come be in Shady's world. I wanna go together. Let's let our love unfurl. You know you want me, baby. You know I want you too. They call me Superman. I'm here to rescue you. I wanna save you, girl. Come be in Shady's world.
Oh boy, you drive me crazy.
Bitch, you make me curl. Superman. Deep tall holes in a single bound. I'm single now. Got no ring on his finger now. I never let another chick bring me down.
Superman continuing with the comic book thing that he did when he was Batman early on, Gotham City, whack rappers, rap criminal stuff. Now he's Superman, and I'm guessing he's playing a chick. He's talking about, well, he's trying to woo her, like come into Shady's world, etc., etc. And he's playing her because he's like, she's like, I love you, baby. He says, I love you too, etc. But then she says at the end, I think I love you, Shady, and then he says, you make me want to hurl. So he doesn't actually like her. She makes him want to throw up, but again, he's playing her. My run is verse back, but I'm going to expect, because of the title of the song, for there to be comic influenced lines and see if I can catch any of them.
You drive me crazy. Bitch, you make me curl. Superman. Deep tall holes in a single bound. I'm single now. Got no ring
now. I never let another chick bring me down in a relationship. Save it, bitch. Babysit. You make me sick. Superman ain't saving shit. Girl, you can jump on Shady's dick. Straight from the hip. Cut to the chase. I tell them all, fucking slide to a face. Play no games. Play no names. Ever since I broke up a butt to face, I'm a different man. Kiss my ass. Kiss my lips. Bitch, why ass? Kiss my dick. Get my cash. I'd rather have you whip my ass. Don't put out. I'll put you out. Won't get out. I'll push you out. Out, popping shit, wouldn't piss on fire to put you out. Am I too nice? Buy you ice, bitch. If you died, wouldn't buy you life. Would you try to be my new wife? What you, Mariah? Fly through twice, but I do know one thing, no.
Alright, so he is clearly jaded from his past relationship. I don't know if that's with Kim or. Because, I mean, I know he's dissed Mariah Carey and Nick Cannon before. I don't recall, or I've never known, if he and Mariah Carey were ever a thing.
Bitches, they come, they go. Saturday through Sunday, Monday. Monday through Sunday, yo. Maybe I'll love you one day. Maybe we'll someday grow. Till then, I sit my drunk ass on that fucking runway, ho.
That's the part that Eminem Drake puts into Chicago Freestyle.
I love that name, love that tattoo. What's that say? Rotten pieces, that's great. First off, you know.
So, in this first off, that was actually funny. The girl, she's being a yes woman, essentially. She's trying to woo him by. She's trying to seduce him by being agreeable, essentially. And he's saying, yeah, girl, run that game because he's seeing.
Right. No Marshall at all.
He's saying, yeah, run that game because he's seeing right through her antics. Like she's even trying when she sees a tattoo saying you're a piece of shit, she tries to play that in a positive way. So he can tell she's kissing ass, trying to get on his dick. Or yeah, either that or wanting his money by getting on his dick. Anyway, let's continue.
That's ammo for my arsenal. I slap you off that barstool. There goes another lawsuit. Leave handprints all across you. Good loaded, loaded. You must be going off that water bottle. You want what you can't have. Ooh, girl, that's too damn bad. Don't touch what you can't grab. End up with two back hands. Put anthrax on the Tampax and slap you till you can't stand. Girl, you just blew your chance. Don't mean to ruin your plans. But I do know one thing, no. Bitches, they come, they go. Saturday through Sunday, Monday. Monday through Sunday, yo. Maybe I'll...
That escalated pretty quickly to gender-based violence. They were just chatting. But yeah, anyway.
Love you one day. Maybe we'll someday grow. Till then, just sit your drunk ass on that fucking runway, ho.
Eminem is very volatile as a human being, or was at this point in time.
I'm here to save you, girl. Come in the Shady's world. I wanna go together. Let's let our love unfurl. You know you want me, baby. You know I want you too. They call me Superman. I'm here to rescue you. I
solid track. Amazing track, in fact. Eminem classic for sure. The next track that we're going to go into, which is actually also a skit, huh? Steve Berman's skit. Maybe Steve Berman is his lawyer. Because I know Paul Rosenberg is his manager.
Hold on a minute. Ma'am, what up? Have a seat. Dre, I'll call you back. What now? I don't even know where to start. Okay. I got the album from upstairs.
Oh, Steve Berman is an exec?
This is by far the most incredible thing I've ever heard.
So what I mean by volatile? And also the way that that scene was playing out, obviously it was meant to make us think that he's gonna trash Eminem's album, because Eminem feels like he's been getting slighted by critics and stuff. So that is volatile, like you're shooting a man before he even gets to finish, and you wonder why people will criticize you and say you've gone off the deep end or whatever. But yeah, that was my reaction, I guess, to the next four tracks. Two of those were skits, so essentially I was reacting to Sing for the Moment and Superman. Both of those songs are amazing songs, amazing Eminem songs. Probably both are top five in this album so far. But yeah, anyway, I've been Zuka the Flame Prince. If you enjoyed this reaction, please go ahead and smash the like button, smash the subscribe button, and share this video with other fans of Eminem you may know. But yeah, with that out of the way, I'm gonna see you guys in the next video. Peace.